Thank you very much for the announcement. Yes, I'm going to talk about GDPR compliance and the type level programming. I previously had, before the corona pandemic, had a talk prepared about how to write a compiler plugin to solve this problem, but actually I came up with another solution for the problem, so I will talk about that, but more on that later. Who am I? I'm Vincent de Haan. I'm from the Netherlands. I live in Amsterdam, and I'm a self-employed Scala engineer. There will be more of those here in the audience, but I am also in possession of a law degree, and I actually started my career at the compliance department of a software company, where it was my job to enhance GDPR compliance on the other side of the table, so to say. And that is where I ran into the problem that I want to talk about today, and that I found some solutions for that I want to explain to you today. All right, so the goals for today, I think, are learn something about type-level programming, macros, and monads, which are quite advanced programming techniques that mostly are used to do something technical in a library or something that is quite far away from the business problems. But I want to take these techniques and apply them to solve a real business problem, which I think is an interesting idea. All right, so I already talked about GDPR, which is an abbreviation of the General Data Protection Regulation, which is a law within the European Union about how to handle personal data. There are a lot of things that this law requires, but one of the things is in Article 30. It requires each controller to maintain a record of processing activities under its responsibility. And what does this mean? It means that if you are a company and you handle personal data, and almost every company handles personal data, you need to make a list of all the processing activities that you do with this data. And then it's not about the fact that you process the data of a specific person on a specific date, but it is that you have a process, for example, for getting the data of your customers, for storing it, for retrieving it when you help them for customer service, for a process for deleting your customers' data. Or maybe you also have a process for the data of your employees, for getting new employees into your database. We'll have a lot of processing activities, and you are required to make a list of those activities, and then for each of those activities you have to judge whether they are in compliance with the GDPR. And then what most companies do, they just take their data model and they look at their database, they look which data do I have, and all right, well, that's of course that's the start, but it is actually about data in motion. So you don't need to make a list of the data you have, but you need to make a list of all the activities that you do with this data. So who can you read it, and when do you read it? When do you delete the data? When do you add new data? And for each of these activities, you need to describe the purposes of the processing, the categories of personal data, and the categories of recipients to whom the personal data have been or will be disclosed. So then there we have the problem. We need to document all our processing activities, but, well, this may sound familiar to some of you, documentation is always incomplete. And documentation is never up to date. And we also have these hidden features that are often poorly documented, like data exporters, this nice button, export all data. Well, mostly it's not in the official requirements that it should be there, but sometimes it's handy to have, but it's not in the documentation. You have logging. Well, logging is almost never fully documented. You have bugs. Well, they are, of course, they are not documented. And you have admin tools that are also not documented. So you can imagine when I was in the compliance department and I asked to the development team, well, what does the application do exactly? They said, well, read the documentation. So I read the documentation, but then I could immediately see that the documentation was not complete because I also used the application, so I knew that it did things that were not in the documentation. But then I got thinking, well, if the documentation is incomplete, what more does it do? So my solution was to learn Scala and to read code, but then I discovered that writing Scala was much more fun than doing compliance work in the compliance department. So I switched to a development career and have been doing that for 4 or 5 years now, which is great, which has been great fun. But the problem has not been solved because someone else is now in the compliance department and he still has the same problem. So we need to find a more permanent solution. And then I came up with this crazy idea. Can we extract the documentation from the code? Because if we can do that, then the documentation will always be complete and up to date. And even if the code contains a bug, then the documentation will contain the same bug. And at least we can talk about it. So then we have to do something during compile time. So not at runtime, but at compile time. And at compile time, we basically have three tools in the Scala world. We have types, with which we can do some calculations. We have macros. Macros are functions that run at compile time and actually generate new Scala code. And we have compiler plugins. And compiler plugins are, I think, the most powerful tool, but they're also the most difficult. And there we can just plug in a new phase into the compiler and transform or analyze the code in any way we want. So I got thinking, and then I came up with this idea. And to be precise, this is not the idea we're going to talk about today. This is the original idea. I thought, well, this personal data mostly resides in the database, and we have then a repository to access it. So we have our repositories, and if we annotate a method in the repository with this processing annotation that I came up with, and then whenever we call this method, we annotate it with this processing instance annotation, where we can give the some description of the processing as a parameter. And then we create a compiler plugin, which does actually two things. For each method with a processing annotation, so for this method, for instance, we need a processing instance annotation at the call site. So we need this annotation. And if we omit it, then the compiler plugin will throw a compiler error. And the second rule is whenever we find this processing instance annotation, we report it, and we create a report that can be sent to the compliance department. Well, if we do it like this, I thought, well, then we solve the problem, because every time you touch the data, you touch the personal data, a report will be created, and the compliance department can work with that. So I thought, so this was my original idea, but it's didn't work because programs are not designed in this way. Programs often have multiple layers, so it's not that from the API implementation you just call the repository, but you often call a service, you call a util, you call some other part of the program that also calls another part, and 3, 4, 5 steps further, then the repository will be called. So I had to pass these annotations through all these layers, and I tried some things, but it didn't work out. It all became only more and more complicated, and it didn't solve the problem. So I had to come up with something else. If you're still interested in how to write a compiler plugin that I described below, I did a talk about that at a conference 1.5 years ago. And if you're interested in writing the compiler plugin, then it's still an excellent talk, I think. But if you are interested in solving the GDPR problem, well, then it doesn't really work if you have a moderately complicated application. So that's why I came up with this new approach. And the new idea is let's introduce a monad, or, well, we will see later that it will be a monad, but let's just call it a wrapper for now. And keep the protected data, the personal data, inside this wrapper, this protected data wrapper that I designed, and unwrap it at the end. And when we unwrap it, then report its purpose. And the idea is that we will transform the data throughout the application, but we will record also the original data type in a second type parameter, and this will not change. So, for example, suppose that we have an address of our customer. So we have the type is address, which may be a case class with the street and the house number, and so on. And suppose that we want to know the coordinates of that address, the geolocation. Then we can use an API, for example, by Google Maps to get the coordinates, which will be two floating point numbers, maybe. So then, after this transformation, the address is transformed to a tuple of two floating point numbers, but the original data type is still address, and the address is still encoded in these two numbers. So we want to record this fact that it is that the source of this data is this address, because that is the kind of personal data that is actually used. But I will be showing a lot of source codes from now on, and I will not explain every bit of it because I will only highlight the interesting parts. So, but if you want to study it later, you can all find it on my GitHub repository. So this is the basic wrapper that I created. So it's a class with two type parameters. So this first type parameter is the type of the data that has been wrapped. And the second type parameter is the type of the original data. And this HList I will explain later. Well, then we have a private value. And because it's private, to get it out, we need to have a getter. And we have this getter method here. But this getter, which just returns the value, can only be called with a data processing justification. So we need a data processing justification, which is also a class which is totally empty. But in order to create such a data processing justification, we need this apply method. And this apply method it creates a new object which also has an apply method which takes a type parameter, which is again this HList, and it takes an implicit data processing reporter with four type parameters, and we will see later why this is useful. So now let's look at this data processing reporter with these four type parameters. This is also an empty class; it does nothing. But we need one, and we can create one with this implicit definition, which calls a macro. And here this keyword macro implies that this method, which I will show hereafter, will be run during compilation. So this is the macro implementation. It takes these four type parameters, and this value parameter context, which tells something about the compilation context that we are in. And it generates an expression, which is actually the compiler representation of a bit of Scala code. And within this macro, we can manipulate the syntax tree that the compiler has created based on our code and that the compiler uses internally. So what we do here is we just create this string, which is the report, with the purpose, the subjects and the recipients and the data types of our data processing, and we print it to the terminal. Well, in this basic example, we just print it to the terminal, but in a more professional environment, you could, of course, export it to a file or do something in your build pipeline to email it to someone. But for now, printing it is sufficient. And then at the end, we create an expression, which is basically just a new empty class, which doesn't do anything. The only reason why we are doing this is because we need to make sure that everything type checks. All right, so now I introduced the parts of the solution to you, but it may be still a little unclear how these parts work together. So let's walk you through the steps now. Suppose we have some protected data in a value of the type int and with a source type t, then we want to get it out. We want to look at this integer and we want to get it out of the wrapper. So we need a data processing justification of type t. All right, so let's create one. And here we see something interesting because I used strings as type parameters. And this is something that is quite uncommon, but it is entirely possible. And we are just defining a little types here, which means that that this denotes a type which can only hold one value, namely the string my purpose. But we are going to use these types actually as string parameters later on for the macro. So we can just create this or protect the data justification this way. Note that here an apply method is called, but we can just omit it here because of the syntactic sugar that will add it. And then here we call a second apply method, and here, as you recall, we also have a type parameter, and the type T is inferred here so that we have a protected data justification of type T. All right. And then we also need the implicit data processing reporter. So we will search for it, and if this implicit def is in scope, which of course we have to make sure of, then it will find this implicit definition. And as you can see, it will fit perfectly because here we have four type parameters and those fit in here as well. So then we create this data processing reporter of exactly the right type. So when the compiler finds this implicit definition to be a good fit for this value here, then it runs this macro and it will print exactly what we want, namely the report of this data processing. So this means that we cannot get the value out of the wrapper unless the compiler generates this report, which is exactly what our goal was. All right, so let's look at an example. And for the rest of this talk, I will talk about a medical application where we have patients with an ID, a name, and an address, and we have medical records with an ID, a patient ID, a disease, and a treatment. And as you can see, one patient can have many medical records. And we define for convenience this type alias for a protected data source of T is a protected data of T with the type of the data inside it is T, and the type of the source type is T as well. And this shapeless thing I will explain in a bit. All right, so suppose we have this method get patients by ID. It takes a string as the ID, and then it returns the protected data source patient. So the only thing we have to do to implement this is add this wrapper around it, and we can use this in our repository. Well, but maybe we also want to have a method that returns not a single thing, but maybe it also returns a list of things. For example, in this method, get all patients, there we maybe have a sequence of patients to return. Well, there I have this second type alias, which takes two type parameters, of which one is a higher kind of type, and of which one is just a regular type. And here we can see that the first type of the protected data, this is actually type which is inside the protected data wrapper, doesn't necessarily have to be the same as this type. Because here, the return value of this thing is a sequence of patients, but the data type which concerns us is still patients. All right, so let's see if we can transform these protected data wrappers. So given a protected data of patients, so which contains a patient, how to get a new protected data holding a string with only the patient's name? Quite an easy transformation, but let's try it. Well, then we need to define a map function. And it's actually quite easy, it just creates a new protected data with the function evaluated. And then if we have a patient, then we just can get its name this way by patient.map underscore name. And note here that the new type of this value is the type of the container is string, because the wrapper contains a string, but it originates from patient, so this is not changed. All right, so we have map, and then a logical question is to ask, do we also have flat map? Well, suppose we have this patient's data type, and we have this type medical records. And we also have a method get patient by name, which takes a string, which is the name, and it returns a patient. And then we have get medical record by patient ID, which takes a patient ID and returns a sequence of medical records. Well, then normally it would be quite easy to get the medical records for Mary, because we just get the patient object for Mary, take the ID, and get then the medical records for that ID. But here with this protected data, it's less easy than that, because, well, the ID of Mary is easy. That's just use map like we saw before. But then we do not know what to put into get medical record by patient ID, because here we need the string, But here we don't have a string, we have a protected data of string. So that's not the same type, so we cannot enter it here. And also we need to get the type here, and it's also not entirely clear what to do, what to put in here. So this is a bit more complicated. All right, well, let me just do a quick intermezzo on H-lists. An H-list is short for heterogeneous list, and it is part of the Shapeless library. So it's not part of the of Scala itself, but it's part of Shapeless, which is a popular library for type-level programming. And we need to know, it's a very complicated library with a lot of applications, but we need to know a few things before we can continue. The first thing is that an HList can hold values of multiple types. So it's an HList of a string. Int can hold a string and an int. And notice that it uses almost the same syntax as regular lists, but that it also uses this syntax on the type level. So you could say that an HList has some relation to a tuple, because a tuple is also a list of a definite size with multiple specified types in it. But HList also has properties of list, because you have operations that are much more list-like, as I will show shortly. So for list operations, we use type classes that are provided by Shapeless. So if we have this list one, which is of type string and then int, for example, like this, and then we have this list two, which is of type int, so it's a list of only length one. And suppose we want to prepend those two lists, well, then we need to have a special prepender, because we need this prepender for each type combination that we can get. We cannot just prepend any H-list. We can only prepend, in this case, these specific H-lists of these types, because at compile time, the types need to be determined already. So we can summon an implicit prepend, which is provided for us by the Shapeless library, for exactly this combination of types, and then we can just apply it, and now this new list will be of the type of the combined type of these types, and it will contain the combined values. So this is how we can do operations on these H lists, and we have operations we have type classes for other operations as well. So we can select items, and we can drop items, or take only a few of them. We have basically all the operations that we have on regular lists. We also have on H lists, but we need the type classes to operate on them. All right, so let's go back to the question about FlatMap, and notice that I already have solved one of the problems here, because here at the second type parameter, my suggestion would be to take this as the type, because we have. Because for this value records of Mary, we have the type will be a sequence of medical record, but this value can only be calculated by using both values of type patient and of type medical records. So from a data processing point of view, both these values or these types are included in this end result. And then still we need to find out what needs to be put here. So let's define FlatMap. And this is a bit complicated, because we need to calculate this type. And that is not at all straightforward because we cannot just append the two types, because then we would have this h nil twice. So we need this this implicit prepend, and this this prepend has a nice type member which calculates the results type. So we can just write it like this, and then the compiler will figure out what's the type of the prepended of the two prepended lists is. And then the flat map operation on the value level is actually quite easy, because we can just do as instance of with the right type, because at the value level actually nothing happens. It's just this protected data wrapper is just an empty wrapper which doesn't do anything. The only thing it does is making sure that the types are handled correctly, but that is something that doesn't have any effect at runtime. So now we can use a for comprehension, and notice that I have written the type here explicitly, but that is just for convenience. But the type inference works perfectly here, so we could just have omitted this type ascription. So we can just use a for comprehension, get the ID like this, get the records like this, and then yield the records which results in a new protected data. So this works actually quite elegant, I think. All right, but how about asynchronous programming? Because the repository that I showed you is not what most repositories look like, because you want to talk to a database mostly asynchronously, for example, using Future or maybe an IO monad or another wrapper that in some way encodes the asynchronous effect. So we want to have our methods like this with a future, and inside the future this protected data source. All right, so let's do the same thing. Let's get all records for Mary. But then it gets a bit awkward, because here the for comprehension thinks it is handling futures, which is obviously true. But then the value of this or the type of this thing will be a protected data. But then it is unclear what should be done here. And what should be done here? So it's and maybe we have to unwrap it in some way, but we don't want to unwrap it yet. So it gets very awkward. But this is a problem that many of you probably have seen before, because this is something that we want to use a monad transformer for. So let's create a monad transformer, which I called protected data T. Well, this is a lot of code that I will not explain into detail. The only thing that is relevant here is that I'm actually cheating a bit, because I need to unwrap the wrapper and then and rewrap it again. So I use this private method getProtected, which just uses an unsafe justification to use the getter of the protected data wrapper. And then after we call this thing, we immediately rewrap it into a new protected data monad. So it's from the outside world it is safe, but here we use an unsafe justification, and this can only be used within the package where this is defined. So from the outside world it is actually safe. All right, so let's try again. And now everything turns out to be quite nice, because we can just wrap the methods with this monad transformer, and then everything works the same way. We can also move the monad transformer up to the repository if we would like to. So that's also a possibility. That depends on the style of the code and the other problems that you may run into. All right. So now it's time to look at a complete example where we can see everything in action. So I've created a simple application that's also on GitHub that can create a report about some patients, and you can get it over HTTP, and it just returns a string with the name and the address and the treatments of that the patient has had. So the report is created by a service. The service takes the repositories that are necessary to get the data, and then it has this method get report by name, which takes a string, and it returns this protected data T of a future and of type string, because the report is a string, and of source type person medical record, because a person and a medical record were used to generate this string. Well, then we do the same thing. Then we do the same thing as we saw before, and we return this string, which is the report. Well, note that here in this class, it is still not clear what the justification for this data processing is, and there may be multiple justifications, because this code may be reused by many different APIs. But here for this report API, we are using it. Well, we have some code from Akka HTTP to get the HTTP server running, and then here we query the report service with the patient name, and what we get back is a protected report. And now we are going to unwrap this report with a data processing justification, and I created some extra syntactic sugar to do this a bit more nicely, so we can define the purpose, the subjects, and the recipients. And only at this point the justification of the data processing is given. So this is the point where the data comes out of the protected data wrapper, and where we can serve it to the clients. All right, so I will demonstrate now that it actually works. So here's the code, and I'm going to run SPT compile. And then hopefully we will see the processing report right away. And look, here it is. So during the compilation, this was generated, and it tells the purpose of the processing. It tells what subject it was. It tells who the recipients are. Well, these are things that are written by the developer, and the developer can, of course, do it incorrectly. But this is extracted directly from the code, so this will never lie. And it says that it tells the data types that were necessary to create the report. So this is something that can be handed over to the compliance department, and then they can say, "Hey, well, I see that you are touching these data types," and then a fruitful discussion can be started about whether this is justified or not. So this, I think, is a quite elegant solution to the problem, where we can extract the compliance documentation directly from the code, All right, well, thanks for your attention, and I would be glad to answer any questions.
Hi, Vincent. Thank you so much for your talk. We have a question here, so let's crack on with it. Could you elaborate again why you need the private Scala GDPR modifier?
Yes, I can. Let me get the codes now so that I can show it. So I assume the question is about this one. And the reason is that we want to get the only way to get the data out of the wrapper is using this method, which requires a justification parameter. So if we would omit this private modifier, then we could just get it out by calling the value member, and that would defeat the purpose of the wrapper.
All right. Thank you, and thank you for showing that in your screen as well. Okay, moving on to our next question. Is this being used in production?
No, at the moment not, but I am talking with the architect at my current company to actually start using it.
Fantastic. You did mention during your talk that people can find documentation on what you were talking about on your Git. Would you like to give us a link and we can make that send that in the chat, make that more available to folks watching?
Yes, I can. It is, of course, on the sheets, but I will also publish it on the chat.
Perfect. Thank you. We have one more question here for you, or a couple more. So let's go on to the next question. Have you looked into whether it would be possible to implement this in Scala 3?
I think it will be possible, but I have not tried it.
All right. So here's another question for you. As far as I understand it, you could simply use map or flat map to pass the value to another function with different purposes. Is this maybe an issue?
Yes, well, as long as you are, as the data is inside the wrapper, you can use it for any purpose you want to. Only when you are going to get it out of it, then you have to specify the purpose. And this is done deliberately because I want to reuse the code as much as I want to. And only when I get it out, then I have to define what the purpose is. The only thing is that it only works well when you are using pure functions, because you can, of course, use map and then in the map use an impure function, which just prints or stores the value somewhere else. And then, of course, the data isn't protected anymore. And this is a problem that seems very hard to solve. So it requires a bit of good programming to use it correctly.
Great. All right, we've got a couple more questions here for you. Because adding this definitely adds complication. Can we have it as a plugin that will decorate existing code and could be removed also when the plugin is off?
Yes, that was actually my original idea with the annotations that I showed in the beginning, because then you could just remove the annotations and nothing would change. But I ran into other problems. So I have not found a solution that is easy to remove but does all the things you want to do.
Okay. All right, the next question. What features or functionality do you see being added in the future, if any?
Yes, well, it was one feature that I want to work on in the next few months is adding lenses to it, because if you have a very large case class with a lot of fields and you only want to pick one out of it, then it would be logical to use a lens and then also specialize the source type to say, well, I've only used this field and nothing else. So that would be something that I will be working on, but it wasn't ready for the talk.
Okay, well, I guess we'll have to forgive you for that one then.
Thank you.
We have one final question here, Vincent. Do you have a strong dependency to libs, or could it be a no dependency library in Scala 3 with using the improved tuples instead of HLIS?
Well, that is an interesting question. I think you still need HLIS, but of course you could just take the part out of Shapeless which we are using here, and I think it will be only 20 or 30 lines. But I'm not sure about all the new features of the tuples in Scala 3, but I think we still would need to use HLIS.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. That is all the questions we have. Cannot say thank you enough for joining us, and I hope you get to enjoy the remainder of the conference this week.
Yes, thank you. I'm looking forward to it.
Have a great day.
All right. Thank you. The same to you. Bye.